So I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this very nice workshop conference. So today I'm going to talk about theoretical challenges in continuous variable quantum key distribution. So this is the outline of the talk. I will start by saying why continuous variables are interesting. The answer is mainly from an experimental point of view. They are very practical. But I know that many people are scared by continuous variables. And I think the reason for this is that there are many kind of difficulties or specificities that come along with continuous variables, and I will try to somehow clarify some of these difficulties in this talk. So some of the specificities are, of course, the formalism, which is quite different from BBIT4. People always ask, where are the bits? Where is the secret when you have continuous variables? So we'll try to explain this as well. And of course, when you deal with continuous variables, you have infinite dimension, you have unbounded distributions, and this brings new difficulties in a theoretical analysis. Okay, so we'll spend most of my time talking about this, and I will conclude the talk by mentioning some important open questions in the field. Okay, so why should you care about continuous variables? The main reason is because of practical considerations. Okay, so I think it's a nice alternative to qubit-based crypto. So if you want to do quantum key distributions, basically you need to do two things. You need to be able to prepare some states, and you need to be able to measure some states. For CVQKD, it's very simple in both cases. So the states that we need, they are coherent states. So they are very easy to prepare. So it's the same as in most implementations of BBIT4 with decoded states, for instance. But you have a more natural encoding of information. You encode information in phase space. And the measurement that you use is called homotone detection. So you don't need photon counters. You just need off-the-shelf coherent detection, okay, that you can buy. So this is very nice. In terms of performance, continuous variables are not so bad. So for metropolitan range, they behave even better than the discrete variables. You get very high rate. But however, if you want to go to very long distances, probably it's not a good idea to use continuous variables. So if you want to go beyond 100 kilometers, you should probably stick with BBIT4 or these kind of protocols. Okay. So this is why you should consider continuous variables. And now we'll try to explain what are the specificities of continuous variable QKD. Okay, so we'll mention three of them. So first, the formalism, what is how do you describe protocols with continuous variables? Then how do you go from continuous variables to bits to get a secret key out? And then I will mention the difficulties linked to infinite dimension. Okay, so let's start with the formalism. So, this is the first difficulty for most people, I think. Okay, so first the states. So what kind of states do you use? So we don't use qubits anymore. And basically the qubits are replaced by optical modes. Okay, so what is an optical mode? So it's just an infinite dimensional Hilbert space, which is spanned by the Fock basis of photon number states. Okay, so it's the Hilbert space spanned by this basis, 0, 1, 2, 3, n, where this number basically counts how many photons you have in the mode. Okay, so what are the states? What do the states look like in this basis? So for instance, so if you use PBAT4, the most famous integral state is just this one, 0, 0, plus 1, 1. So if you move to continuous variables, some of this state is replaced by this one, which is called a two-mode squeeze vacuum state. So it's parameterized by a parameter, squeezing parameter, which is called lambda. And the state looks like this, so it's 0, 0, plus lambda times 1, 1, plus lambda squared, 2, 2, etc. So you need this lambda to be less than 1 if you want this state to be normalizable. Okay, so this state is really the one that replaces the maximally integral state for BBIT4. Okay, so in general, it's not easy to describe the states in this Fock basis because you have infinite number of parameters. So a much more convenient way to represent the states is using their Wigner function. So what is a Wigner function? It's a quasi-probability distribution over R2 if you have a single mode. So the two coordinates of R2, x and p, they are called the quadratures of the field, and this is the phase space. And so this distribution is not a probability distribution because it can take negative values. Okay, and this Wigner function, it encodes all the information that you have in your state. Okay, so it's equivalent to have the density matrix, or it would be given this Wigner function. And with this kind of formalism, the states that are interesting, they are very nice, and they correspond to Gaussian states. Okay, so if you look at single mode continuous variable state, you have basically two families of nice states. You have the coherent state, like the one that I produce with this laser pointer, which has a Gaussian distribution. So this Wigner function has a Gaussian distribution. So it's centered on a point in phase space. And the variance along the x-axis is the same as the variance along the p-axis. So this is a coherent state. And you have three states, which are centered also on a point in phase space. And now the variance is different depending on whether you consider the x quadrature or the p quadrature. Okay, so here you have squeezing in the x quadrature. And in general, the covariance matrix of the state, it cannot be arbitrary. It has to satisfy an uncertainty relation of this form. Okay, so these are the states that you use in continuous variable QKD. So what are the measurements that you can do? So I said that each single mode state is described by this Wigner function. So the Wigner function can be negative, but it turns out that if you integrate the Wigner function along one quadrature, so either P or X, you get a single dimensional distribution, which is non-negative, and which gives you a probability density function. Okay? And homodyne detection is just basically sampling from these distributions. So if you want to do homodyne detection of the X quadrature, for instance, it means that you integrate your Wigner function along the p quadrature, you get a distribution, and you sample according to this distribution. So basically, you can measure the x coordinate or the p coordinate. So these are called domain measurements for the x quadrature or the p quadrature. And these two measurements, they play a role similar to measuring in the 0-1 basis or in the plus-minus basis for qubit states. So this is one type of measurement that you can do. There is a second type of measurement you can do. It's called heterodyne detection. So it's not possible to measure both X and P at the same time. But what you can do is kind of cheat a little bit, and you can basically send your state into a balanced beam splitter. You get two output modes, and you measure the X quadrature for one output mode, and you measure the P quadrature for the second output mode. And this way, you get two measurement outcomes, and they give you some, they give you some approximation of what you would have measured if you had done just an X measurement or a P measurement. So this is the heterodyne detection. It's more symmetric. An alternate description of this detection is just the projection onto coherent states. Okay. Basically, you do this kind of measurement. You do the measurement where you project onto coherent states, and you get a complex value as the outcome, which corresponds to these two real values. So these are the two kind of measurements that we want to consider, homodyne detection and heterodyne detection. Okay, so now we have the states, we have the measurements. So what are the protocols? Well, basically, they are the simplest protocols you can think of, the Gaussian protocols. The idea is just ICE prepares a two-mode squeeze state. So I said that these states, they play the same role as the EPR pair for qubits. So she prepares a bunch of those. She keeps one mode, she sends the other mode to Bob, and then they both measure their optical modes. So they can do either, they both measure.